What if I told you the most important livestock on your property aren't the ones you go out to the coop or the pasture to feed, but something that builds the foundation of everything else? Today, we're talking about worms. Both the earthworms living in your soil and the composting worms you can farm yourself. And we're going to look at why building living soil is fundamentally different from buying in fertility. Let me take you back in time. For as long as humans have been farming, at least 10,000 years, we've been making compost and partnering with worms. Different cultures did it in different ways, but they all understood something fundamental. The ancient Greeks called earthworms the intestines of the soil. Aristotle knew that they were essential to farming. Egyptian farmers along the Nile recognized their value so much that there's a legend Queen Cleopatra banned the export of earthworms. They were too valuable to Egypt's agricultural success to let anyone else have them. Think about that. Earthworms as strategic resources worth protecting. For thousands of years, every culture that farmed successfully was essentially partnering with worms to maintain soil fertility. Because there were no synthetic fertilizers available, you had to work with natural systems. Until the Industrial Revolution in the mid-19th century, all farming was what we'd consider today to be organic farming. Some cultures were better than others at returning fertility to their soils, but ultimately everyone had to farm in a similar way. Then in 1842, everything changed. The invention of superphosphate, the very first synthetic fertilizer. People began to understand the chemical properties that made up the natural world. They discovered nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, NPK, the letters you see on bags of fertilizer. And that resulted in a shift towards considering the world from a chemical and mechanistic perspective. This began to push agriculture away from its coupling with natural systems. People got excited about this new modern approach. Just throw it down from a packet and everything's going to grow. It was fashionable. It was fast. And people started losing interest in the more traditional ways of farming, where you would partner with earthworms to keep your soil fertile. Things went a bit downhill for earthworms. People weren't paying them a heck of a lot of attention anymore. They were going with the bang for your buck farming, throwing chemicals down, which are not good for earthworms, and mechanical tilling, which essentially just pulverizes worms in that area. We went from honoring them as the intestines of the soil to actively destroying them without even thinking about it. Here's the fundamental difference. If you don't have all of that biology happening in your soil, you don't have soil. You only have dirt. You can have the mineral components, the clay, the sand, the silt, but without the trillions upon trillions of microorganisms, without the organic matter, without the worms and the living soil web, you just have dirt. Chemical fertilizers can make plants grow in dirt, but they can't make soil. And now we're seeing the cracks in that system, degrading soil health, dependence on external inputs, soils that don't hold water, that don't store carbon. But the biological approach never went away. Even through the height of industrial agriculture, people kept working with natural systems. In the 1970s, when the cracks in industrial agriculture were starting to show, people started getting much more interested again in sustainable and organic ways of gardening and farming. This is where composting worm farming really came into its own. Mary Appelhoff became known as the Worm Lady. She championed home composting with worms and wrote the classic text, Worms Eat My Garbage, in 1982. That's still a great resource today. There was even a worm farm scam era. get-rich-quick schemes that did a lot of damage to the credibility of the industry. But that actually proves the point. You wouldn't build scams around something that wasn't genuinely valuable. And vermicomposting is a massively beneficial way to deal with organic waste. Today, worm farming is pretty normal. There are heaps of different kinds of systems you can buy to suit pretty much any situation. The knowledge is out there. The systems work. So here's the fundamental choice we still face. The industrial path. Apply NPK, kill everything else with pesticides and herbicides, till and disrupt the soil, fight the system constantly, depend on external inputs. Or the ecological path. Partner with soil life, create habitat for them, let them manufacture the nutrients and build the soil structure you need. And worms, both earthworms and composting worms, are the mechanism by which this living soil partnership works. Let me help you understand the scale of what we're talking about. You can think of the rich mix of biology in your soil like a larger ecosystem, like a jungle or a savanna. Except each one of those ecosystems is present in just one teaspoonful full of soil. It's kind of mind-boggling to think of it on that scale. And the larger animals that live in the soil that we can actually see, like earthworms, are the whales or the elephants in that soil ecosystem. The megafauna doing the heavy lifting. Here's the key. Earthworms aren't just present in good soil, they're making good soil. All of that biology, the wonderfulness in that soil ecosystem, it drives nutrient cycling, the web of life in the soil that makes all life on Earth possible. Earthworms do three critical things. First, they're infrastructure builders. They improve soil health and plant health by making their burrows through the ground, which helps air and water get into the soil profile. They travel up and down through the layers, depending on the species. Some go deeper, some stay shallow. But they're all creating these highways for air and water to move through the soil. Secondly, they're doing vertical nutrient transport. They move the minerals in the soil up through all those layers to help mix all of that together, bringing nutrients from deep in the soil profile up to where plant roots can access them. Over time, this really helps your soil become just a vibrant, wonderful environment for all the plants and animals and microbes that live there to be really healthy. Thirdly, and this is the magical part, soil aggregation. As they move the soil through their bodies and out the other side as worm castings, worm poop, all of those materials have compounds in them that help the particles of the soil clot together. This is called soil aggregation. The structure, how the soil feels and behaves and holds water, all works together much, much better when you have lots of earthworms present. This is what allows soil to hold water without becoming waterlogged, to store carbon, to support plant roots, to maintain air spaces within the soil. Now, before we talk about how to encourage earthworms, let me quickly distinguish between earthworms and composting worms, because they do different things and you want both of them. Earthworms live in the soil. They travel up and down through the layers. They're building soil structure deep down. Composting worms work in the top layer, the organic matter layer of the soil. They don't really go much further than just the first couple of centimeters at most into the actual soil itself. Their job is to rapidly break down all the dead things that drop onto the ground and turn it back into plant available nutrients. And they're really helpful because you can harness them to work for you a little bit more easily than you can with earthworms. Both of them cycle nutrients. Both earthworms and composting worms do that same job of taking decomposing organic matter and turning it into a form that plants can uptake and keep growing. They're the foundation of all health in the system. Today we're mainly focused on earthworms because they're the deeper foundation, but composting worms complement the system, and we'll talk about them in a minute. So how do you invite earthworms to move in? Here's the fundamental shift in thinking. You're not managing earthworms. You're creating habitat, and they choose to colonize that habitat. This is a completely different approach from industrial agriculture. You're not controlling, you're inviting. What do earthworms need? They need surface protection. Earthworms really need shelter and protection when they come up to the surface. Having places for them to hide from their predators allows them to come up to the surface safely to do their work. What does this look like? Living plants, mulches, wood chips, straw laid on the ground, bits of wood or logs scattered around. Basically, never leave bare soil exposed. Now, what should you avoid? Chemical damage. Using herbicides, insecticides, and fungicides on your property will negatively impact earthworm health. Finding other ways to manage pests in your environment is really important if you want to support earthworm populations. And here's the thing, those alternative pest management approaches work because you're supporting the whole ecosystem. I see this all the time in my own system. It's very common as we come into late spring, I'll have something in the greenhouse that becomes covered in aphids. That's a good signal to me that it's no longer suitable for that plant to be in the greenhouse. It needs to come out. If I bring it out and leave it in the garden where there are growing plants around it, where the soil biology is intact, where the ecosystem is functioning, the aphids will be gone in 24 hours. It's quite magical and a lot cheaper than doing any other kind of intervention. That's what happens when you have healthy soil with healthy biology. The system regulates itself. The other thing to avoid, too much mechanical damage. Using things like mechanical tilling, like a rototiller, essentially just pulverizes earthworms in that area. Using minimum tillage practices really helps earthworm populations be supported. Here's the bigger picture. Healthy soil requires healthy plants, and healthy plants require healthy soil. They're one symbiotic organism working together. Honestly, I'm not even sure if plants and soil are separate from each other. The soil is sort of the digestive system of the plants. It's the communication system of the plants. And the plants feed the soil from the processes that they do. They just work together. Now let's talk about composting worms, the ones you can actively farm. Worms are incredible decomposers. They're capable of reducing organic waste by as much as 80%. That is a much better percentage than you get from large-scale hot composting systems. And the end product, the vermicompost, is much more valuable to put on the soil than just standard compost. It really supercharges your seed raising mixes and your potting mixes. But here's what makes composting worms so powerful as a starting point. Anyone can have this livestock. Living in an apartment with a balcony, you can have worms. Renting and might move, worms come with you. Can't have chickens due to space or regulations? Start with worms. They scale infinitely down to any space you have available. They're legitimate livestock that cycle nutrients and reduce waste, but they're accessible to absolutely anyone. Like I mentioned earlier, today worm farming is pretty normal. There are heaps of different kinds of systems you can buy to suit pretty much any situation. You've got worm farms that can be inside, worm farms that can be outside, small ones, big ones, ones that are open to the ground, and ones that are completely closed. There are some really clever systems like the Hungry Bin, which is probably the coolest worm farming home-based system that I've seen. You can DIY it with plans from the internet. Pretty much, if you want to have a worm farm and make your own compost, you can do it in a system that works for you. My own approach is pretty simple. I use those black plastic compost bins, the square ones with lids. I set them up in a shady spot and fill them with all sorts of organic matter. Kitchen scraps, garden waste, horse manure, chicken bedding and manure once it's had some time to mellow out. And the worms move in and do their work. And because these bins are open at the bottom, the worms can actually move in and out freely if they want to. They're not completely trapped in there. But here's my actual goal. I'm not trying to contain the worms. I'm trying to create conditions where both composting worms and earthworms thrive throughout my entire property. The progression looks like this. Composting worms in bins break down kitchen scraps and garden waste and whatever other organic matter I put in there. That creates enhanced compost. I spread that compost on garden beds and use it in my seed-raising mix. It feeds the soil biology. Then earthworms are attracted to those areas. The living soil system spreads. This even scales up to commercial operations. Here in New Zealand, there's a company called Mainoke that does this at farm scale. They take organic waste, put it on farmland in a rotation, run worms through it to reduce it down. They end up with farm soil that's much enhanced in fertility and a worm casting end product to sell. It's proof that these systems work from balcony scale all the way up to commercial agriculture. The key is just starting. The specific system you use matters less than just beginning somewhere, anywhere. Pick what works for your space and your situation. Start partnering with those worms. So here we are. Full circle. The ancient Egyptians understood this. The Greeks got it right. Aristotle knew. For thousands of years, successful farming meant partnering with worms. We took a detour through chemical agriculture, and to be fair, it worked in the short term. It fed billions of people. That's not nothing. But we're remembering now what was always true. You have two fundamental choices for how you feed your garden. You can keep buying inputs, fighting the system, depending on external solutions, treating your soil like dirt that you can pour things onto. Or you can partner with the soil life that manufactures what you need. Build living soil instead of buying fertility. Worms, both earthworms and composting worms, are how you make this shift. Whether you've got acres or a balcony, you can start this partnership today. Create habitat, avoid harm, let them do what they've been doing since before humans started farming. Add some mulch, stop using chemicals, start a small worm bin. These creatures have been building soils, cycling nutrients, and making life on land possible for millions of years. They're not waiting for permission, they're just waiting for an invitation.